hacienda swans, the bounty hunters will call your number. Rolling 30s and 20 outlaw systems rooms will put you under. Cabbage patch, center port, Harvard Park, Athens Park 2, Scottsdale neighborhood, off on waterfront, all power roots, LA Denver Lane, this one with Pasadena.
Just waking up in the morning, gotta thank God. I don't know, but today seems kinda odd. No barking from the dog, no small. And mama cooked the breakfast with no hog. Life changes, time rearranges. Visions of my head of one day being famous.
Probably gonna sin again. Lord, forgive me. Lord, forgive me. Things I don't understand. Hello? Hello? Caller? Well, the hell with it there. This is something new for the underground.
Right about now, you're about to be possessed. By the sounds of OG Music Zone, G-Lew.
Ladies and gentlemen, once again, it's your boy G-Lew. Back doing what I do. Back again for the next installment. This is the G-Lew Show. I want y'all to sit back because we're going to have a real good time. You know what I mean? Yeah. This is OG Music Room. Now I'm your maestro for the evening. G-Lew. Yeah. We're going to have a real nice show tonight. I got a lot of special guests stopping through. Some surprises, you know what I mean? So I want y'all to just sit back and ride with me. G-Lew Lee. Yeah.
Crank it up and piss off the neighbors. You got your radio locked on to the hottest station.
Welcome to the G-Lew Show podcast. This is episode 8. I am G-Lew, the maestro for the evening. And tonight, you know, you may have heard about it, you may have not, but we have a very, very, very special guest tonight. We have the lovely, and when I say lovely, I don't mean that lightly, but she's lovely and smooth and sweet on the inside, but on the outside, she's harder than a motherfucker. We got the lovely Ms Moma Boo with us tonight on the G-Lew Show podcast. Let me introduce Mama Boo now. Hello, hello, Mama Boo.
Hello. Hey.
Hey, how are you tonight?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm doing good. I'm doing good. Are you okay? Are you ready for this?
I'm going to have to be. I mean, stay ready, so I have to get ready. So let's roll with it.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Let's get serious. Now, first of all, before we start, I want to introduce you again to the show. Welcome to our show, the G-Lew Show podcast. We're honored to have you here. Secondly, I want to say happy Valentine's Day to you. Being that it's the day after Valentine's Day, happy Valentine's Day to you as well. And welcome to the
Thank
show.
Thank you. Same to you.
Mhm. All righty. First and foremost, let's get into it. Intimate conversations with Mama Boo. Yeah, I gotta sound like that, right? But for real though, we're gonna talk about a lot tonight. You know what I mean? We're gonna take it to different levels. We're gonna talk a little bit just about Mama Boo, whatever she wants to talk about, but just a little history of Mama Boo. for the people who may or may not know or may have heard some things before or didn't get the real or whatever the case. We want to talk about that. Then we want to talk about your growth, you know, from baby boo-boo to a grown boo, you know, and the things that you have going on, and eventually to what you have going on now with all the positive things you're doing in your life at this time. So, you know, we want to just start it off with a little bit of background history on Mama Boo. First, Boo, like, where does the Mama Boo story start at? Like, where did you grow up at, and, you know, where did everything get started for Mama Boo? Or Boo? How do you want me to address you tonight?
Mama Boo, that's my name.
Okay. Just making sure.
Yeah, you good. Well, basically, grew up in Athens from the age of 6. And my mother, she still currently lives there. So I'm a native of Athens. I'm part of the Athens life.
Right. Hey, Boo. Let me ask you this.
Yes.
Before we continue, I didn't mean to cut you off. Before we continue, I wanted to ask you this. Can you break down the structure and the areas of Athens? Because that is an unincorporated part of Los Angeles, but it sits in between or right on the border of a lot of places. You know what I mean? Can you tell us, like, the dynamics of Athens Park or Athens area?
Basically, it's the L.A. area. We're connected to Westside Power, which is right down the street. We have Village Town, which they are no longer still there, but we was directly close to them as well. We have the Millers a little bit down the street. We have Diver Lanes. Going backwards the other way, we have the Fives. So we're in a circle of all of that. Basically, we will say El Segundo. No, we wouldn't even say El Segundo. We could say 135th all the way to, you say, Avalon. Backwards, you will go to Figueroa. And then cross over, you'll go all the way to 120th. So we're all in that section right there.
Okay. But the area, kind of like how Athens is connected also to Compton, because I know you went to school in Compton or the Compton district. Can you break down how your childhood was and you know, growing up in the Athens area where you went to school, and how was your school life as a youngster?
Yeah, Athens is directly connected to Compton. Like, that's the next city over. So my schools were Compton Unified School District with Mark Twain. That's located over in Westside Piru behind where Enterprise Park is at. But Mark Twain is no longer there. And Vanguard is Compton as well, as far as in the address, if I'm not mistaken. But that's right there on 132nd and San Pedro to 135th and San Pedro. And Centennial, that is a Compton address, which is on El Segundo and Central. So Centennial is where I finished school at.
Right. Okay. And how was your childhood years coming up, you know, going to school? How were you in school? Like, were you good in school at first or changed later? Or how were your school years from elementary to junior high to high school at Centennial?
From kind of elementary
Mama
to Mama Boo was a badass kid. I wasn't up to par with reading throughout my entire school life, all the way through high school. I was always behind in reading, math, everything. So basically, I was a kid that's always acted out in school, always wanted to fight. You know, I didn't want attention on me when it came to academics, but I loved the attention on me with the bullshit. So Mama Boo was a bad little girl, like fighting boys, girls. It really didn't matter, but it was all because if you were to ask the grown Mama Boo why I was like that, it was because there was really no structure in the household, and I wasn't up to par with school, so I would act out in class. So the attention wouldn't be on that I can't read, really couldn't write or do math. So I was bad. And I didn't really get it together until after school, even though I did graduate Centennial and walk the stage, but I wasn't up to par.
Right. Did you have any brothers and sisters growing up, or were you only child?
I'm on my mom's side. I have an older brother, which is 7 years older than me. And on my dad's side, it's about 11 of us. But growing up, it was just me and my brother with my mom's side until maybe 11 years old. Then I kind of connected with my brother on my father's side, and that was just them two.
Mm.
So I've always been like the baby.
Right. And you said your brother was 11 years old or 7 years old. What type of influence did he have on you, if any?
He didn't have any influence on me. He didn't have no influence on me because he has a mental problem, so like a mental disability. So it was more like he was always seen and not heard, and then I was the one that was seen and heard. So I was like the bad kid in the house.
Right.
But my brother was just easygoing, and anybody that do know my brother, they know that he don't really too much talk. You know, he's just, you will see him, you will not hear him, you will see him. He a cool dude, but he's not talking too much. Like, it's really nothing really going on as far as in him just, you know, acting or anything like that.
Right. Well, being that you had a brother but in the household but didn't interact or was a major influence on you, who were some of your influences growing up, if any, that you had that you did kind of look up to or you could turn to or just somebody that you respected older than you as you were growing up?
As I was growing up, I would say my next-door neighbor, Val, she was a big influence on me because she had her kids, and one of her daughters is my age, and me and her been rocking since sixth grade, which is, give a shout-out to Chanel. So she was a big influence because different things that my mom didn't teach me, like cooking, doing hair and different stuff like that, I learned that next door. So she was a big influence, I would say, until I got to high school. And then once I got into high school, then I would say another influence on me was Beverly. She's from Bonnie Hunters, but she used to live in the AP. So shout out to B. She was an influence on me. I wouldn't say positive or I wouldn't say negative. I would just say it was just more what it was that I was doing. She was basically teaching me the ropes and telling me what I should and what I shouldn't do. And my biggest influence was my homegirl, Lily, rest in peace. She was like my hood mom. So those are the people that had a big influence on me. Because Lily, she was one of the people that I can talk to about anything. And she basically taught me how to stand on my word and, you know, just be aggressive out there with getting money and gangbanging and all that. But she was a female telling me this. So, like I say, rest in peace to Lily, but she was like my hood mom.
Right. Rest in peace, Lily. Boo, at what point of your journey or going through these stages of your life, does the gang aspect come in? Because you grew up in the neighborhood already, so I'm sure you were exposed to it and seen it, heard about it, knew about it. But, you know, as we come up in age, we go through different stages. What part of your life did this aspect of life start to get a hold of you and influence you to the point that you wanted to be a part of this Athens Park thing or your neighborhood?
I would say when I really just, like, paid attention to it, I would say maybe seventh grade. And around seventh grade, that's when my dad got killed. So it was me being angry and lashing out. And then I started to, you know, hear different hoods and different stuff like that. And then coming home after school and walking around and hearing, you know, Anthony's this or whatever the case may be. So I would say about seventh grade is when I started paying attention to it. But more so as in gangbanging, I would say about eighth, for sure, ninth grade.
Right. And we didn't speak too much about your mother, but I've heard you speak about her before in past and some things, issues or whatever. But what part did your mom play in any? We spoke about a lot of influence, non-influences. What part, if any, did your mother play in your life as far as positive or negative?
Well, for people that do know and people that don't know, my mom has been on drugs all my life, so that's all I know of her. Up until recently, maybe like the last 2 or 3 years, and that was because of medical issues. But the role that she played me being grown now is that she gave me stability. You know what I mean? I didn't have to worry about living from pillow to post, even though she was on drugs. She was not a streetwalker or anything like that. You know, she would do what she done in the house. And I never had to worry about, you know, where me and my brother was going to be, you know, lights being turned off or anything like that. Now, we didn't have the food per se that we wanted to eat and things like that, but I never was cold. You know what I mean? She never had a revolving door with men coming in and out of her house. That was never the case. I mean, I can count on my hand, one hand, how many boyfriends that I've known she's had. And so I've never been subject to being molested or anything like that. But at the same time, it wasn't no guidance. You know what I'm saying? Because her main thing was drugs, and she's not really a boisterous person like I am. So it was a lot of things that I wanted to talk to her about that she wouldn't talk to me about. No difference than when my father passed away. When he passed away, you know, the detectives came maybe like 3 in the morning, and I woke up because I heard the door, of course, and they let her know what was going on. So she let me know, you know, once they left or whatever. But me and my mother has never had a conversation about how did that affect me? What do I feel? It was never a conversation at all pertaining to my dad passing away. It was just one of those things where he passed away. And then now it's like, you know, we're at the funeral. And then now I'm at the funeral with my uncles and aunties and cousins that I really don't know. And mind you, at this time, I'm only 12 years old. So it's like one of those things where I'm just going through the motions and I don't know how to express myself because she's not opening the door for me to express myself. I don't know how to feel, really. I'm just a confused little kid. So with that being said, it really wasn't no dialogue in my household. It really wasn't no conversations in my household when it came to gangbanging, when it came to boys, when it came to school. Because mind you, like I say, I was behind my grade throughout of all school. So she never addressed that or never even tried to address that. So, you know, but I really can't say it was just 100% bad because I've never been in a situation where I had to fend for myself because of something my mama done or was negligent doing. So it's like a bittersweet thing. You get what I'm saying? Like I raised myself,
right.
But at the same time, I had a home. You get what I'm saying? Like I had somewhere to stay. I wasn't one of those kids that was in foster care or nothing like that. Are we living here, living there? Like I said, my mom been over there since I was 6 years old and she's still there. So, you know, that right there was one of the things where I never had to worry about nothing like that. Like most people that may have a parent that's on drugs, you know, it's a lot that comes with that, that I didn't have to go through.
Right. Right. Let me ask you this, Boo, a two-part question. Speaking on everything that you just spoke about with the home front and the home life, what was going on inside the home, family issues and all that, I want to ask you, first part, do you think that played a part of you, the words you use, acting out in school and growing up and doing the things you were doing, do you think that played a part in how you acted and acted out, you know, coming up? And you spoke about really being involved in the gang life, starting to really get involved eighth grade or so. We know at this point you're still a child, you know, but you're growing up fast. You know what I mean? 13, 12, 13. What were some of the early stages of that? And also early stages of, you know, because it's levels of gang banging and being a part of this type of thing. You know, how was it early on for you in adapting to that and knowing what you were really involved in? You know, as it got more serious, being that you were so young at that point in your life. I know that was a lot to ask, but I wanted to
that
ask
those
two.
That was a lot, and I'm trying to get it together here.
Okay. So,
but the first
was just the home life.
Right. That played a big part because just me looking at, for me, for an example, with me having my kids in the sports and me always being up there at their school, popping up at their school, it played a big part because I didn't have that person that had that structure and had her hand on my head. You know what I mean? Like, you have to do this, you have to do that. So I had a big world of do whatever you want to do to a certain limit. You know what I mean? So it played a big part because I was able to do it and I didn't have to worry about her coming outside to snatch me up or about when I go in the house, me getting in trouble. So it played a big part with not having structure and not having a solid foundation at home for me to open the door to go outside and be able to gang bang and all of that. Now, what was the second question?
Okay, the second, let me rephrase it and explain it again because I know that was a lot. But I want to ask you, being that you were so young, which is common, you know, but being so young, like eighth grade, when you really got involved with things, how was that for you early on, the early stages of that gang life and realizing, you know, what you're involved in? Because you went to school like in Compton, surrounded with a lot of different neighborhoods, even though a lot were other bloods. How was that early on for you experiencing that and knowing, you know, what you were a part of and how serious it became, you know, over time?
It was easy for me because it was a way to be violent on little kid levels. You know what I mean? And like I said not too long ago, with me not having structure in the house, and then at the same time, we've got to put it in perception that my father had just passed and I didn't have an outlet, you know. I didn't have no type of counseling or just interactions and conversations with my mom, so I was angry. So with that being said, it was just easy. I mean, I didn't have no problem with gangbanging or nothing like that because it was one of those things where as little as I was, I could fight. So with that, it's like, you know, you get the little respect and, you know, you think you hard, you think you the business. And then it transformed into, say, about Centennial, where we're at, I'm in high school, and then now we're fighting different hoods for whatever little petty reasons. And then we'll say toward the ending of high school, I say I was in 12th grade the first time I went out of state. So with me going out of state, it was one of those things, like, I'm in it, you know what I mean, where the older homeboys is talking to me and they showing me different little ropes of how to do this and that and the other. So now it's becoming more serious to me. And then now I'm reflecting on why my daddy is not here. So with me knowing where he got killed at, that was, like, my place to run to do whatever it was I wanted to do, because I felt like I want to knock one of y'all down because y'all took my daddy from me.
Mm-hmm.
So it got serious.
Right.
We'll say 11th grade is when it started getting a little more serious, because now we fighting with hoods up there at the school, or, you know, anybody from the opposite side that we seeing, we just mashing on them. Like, my little crew, Three the Hard Way, we was bad as hell. And that's why the smokers used to call us Three the Hard Way. We was bad.
Hmm.
So,
right.
You know, it just got serious by the time I started to realize where was that my dad got killed at. That's really was the thing, and I really believe that had my mama talked to me, I probably wouldn't have had all that anger.
Right. And was your dad from the neighborhood, or was he involved in that, or was that something separate?
That was something separate, because my dad,
okay,
prior to him passing away, he had been in the penitentiary for, I think he had just done 6 or 7 years prior to him getting out, and he got murdered about a year after he got out. So my dad had always been in the pen, and from my understanding, he was from bounty hunters. So it was just one of those things where after he passed away and I got into my teens, my aunties and them, they used to be like, you act just like your daddy. And I used to be offended about that. Like, why the fuck y'all keep telling me about somebody I don't even fucking really know like that, you know? And then once I start having kids, I can tell different traits of my kids that they do, you know, our DNA. And it's like, okay, oh,
right,
that's what my aunties then was talking about, because I was violent. And my mama is not, I've never even seen my mama really argue with nobody. Damn sure have never seen her fight. She's not that type of spirited person. So with them saying what they were saying to me, it was offensive to me to hear it, because y'all don't know what I'm going through. I wish my daddy was here, and then you telling me I act like him, and I don't understand what the fuck you talking about. How I act like somebody I don't know. But now I get it. You know what I'm saying? Like, he was violent on a lot of levels. It's a lot of people, like my uncles, my mother, brothers, that was petrified of my daddy. So now I get what they were saying. But it was nothing that was taught to me. He never taught me to be like that, because for the year he was around, he lived with us 6 months, and then 6 months later, he moved out. So I really only know my daddy, like, really 6 months, maybe 7 months of my life. If you just put it all together, the times I've been around him, we'll say about 7 months of my life, and I've never even seen him mad.
Right. Wow. Let me ask you this, Boo. First, before I continue on, you spoke about your mother again and her being transitioning, being sober for some years now. What's your relationship like with your mother now, these days?
I don't have a relationship with my mother.
Okay. We can leave it at that. I didn't, you know.
Yeah.
I just wanted to ask. We can leave it at that. But back to the other story, I want to ask you, you said you had a crew, Three the Hard Way. So I was going to ask you that next. How was it like now transgressing from the 8th to the 9th grade Centennial? You know, you have in it, you know what I mean, but you're a female. You know, I want to ask you from a female perspective, how it was being involved, you know, in the gang life and doing what you had to do, you know what I mean, from a female's perspective, because, you know, we don't get that a lot. I asked you that before, but I want to go deeper into that because, you know, that's a story we don't get a lot. You even speak about on your channel, you know, how things are harder for the homegirls and the homeboys don't really reach back or whatever. However, you know what I mean? How was it like for a female doing what you did And did you have a crew, which you just spoke about? You know what I mean? Going to these other schools, did you have homegirls that was with you, or did you have the fam for yourself? How was that?
As far as in school, it was me and my two homegirls. And 12th grade, me and one of my homegirls went to see a Chavez, which is basically a Crip school off of Wilmington and 127th, if I'm not mistaken. And that right there was like, it was, that was a lot, because we was nowhere near no punks. So we was up there at that school, flame the hell up every day, but really didn't nobody press up on us. But it was just a lot. But what I see as far as in the difference between the females and the males is that the females that gang bang, we're not only trying to prove to the men, to the males, that we're hard and that we really with it and that we not no snitch, or, you know, that we really can get down, or we really down to go on missions, but we got to prove to other females as well that we're the hardest female in the clique. So, and that's different from men. Men don't have to prove to the females that they hard. You know what I'm saying? They just proving it to other males. But a female growing up in a gang life or whatever, it's like double jeopardy. You know what I mean? It's like we got to prove to the men, and at the same time, we got to prove to the females as well. And then God forbid if you a thot or back in the day a hood rat, you really ain't proving nothing.
Right, right, right. Facts, facts. Boo, I want to ask you, too. I got that perspective from a woman's perspective, being involved in this gang life and all that. What would you say, though, was the changing factor, you know, being involved in this life? You're going through high school now, fights here and there, doing your stuff or whatever. But what was maybe some of the life-changing events that really, 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 you know, made you realize how serious this shit is or can get? You know what I mean? Kind of events maybe that changed your life, you know, in this shit, when it got serious for you?
It got serious for me when I got cautious with what it is that I was doing and how I was conducting myself and carrying myself, is when I got pregnant with my daughter. Prior to that, I didn't have no problem with nothing that I was doing. I mean, as stupid as it sounded and as stupid as I was, I really was like walking around here with no fear. And thinking about it now, that's stupid as hell, because I put myself in situations, what I call playing Russian roulette with myself, but not actually with a gun or nothing like that to my head, but playing Russian roulette with myself by being flamed up out of pocket in other hoods and giving zero fucks. So once I got pregnant with my daughter, it was one of those things where, you know, I'm pregnant and I don't want nothing to happen to my baby. It wasn't really nothing about me. It was my baby. So that right there kind of started to change my life. And a lot of things with the hanging out, with a lot of different stuff, the car that I used to have, I stopped driving that car maybe 2-3 weeks after I found out that I was pregnant with her, because I know that that car is a known car. Everybody know that chick that got that car. She from Athens. Everybody know that. So my thing was, I stopped driving that car. So that was a major change for me. One of the major changes for me was when I got pregnant with my daughter.
Right, right. Did you ever have to, like, get cracked or have to do some jail time due to anything you were doing, or did you escape that part?
I escaped all of that. All of that.
Okay.
Like, I've never even been to jail other than, like, some bullshit that ain't got nothing to do with that. And that was just being detained.
Right.
But, no, I escaped all that. I swear, God did not want nothing to happen to me. Because the things that I done, I should still fucking be locked up right fucking now. But God forbid, did nothing happen to me. You know what I mean? I'm still here. I'm able to change my life and be a mother to my kids.
That part. Now, speaking about when you got pregnant, right? Let's switch gears, because now you go from Mama Boo doing what you do out there, active and all of this and that, right, to meeting your baby father and, like you said, getting pregnant and all that. But it's a dynamic to that whole story, you know what I mean, for you know, this is public record because he spoke about it, but being that your baby's father was much older than you. How did that even happen, come to play? How did you guys connect and later on become, you know, a family, because you were with him for many years? So it wasn't just something that happened, but how did all of that come into play, being that you were so young and active and doing your stuff, to going to being pregnant and changing your life, calming down and all of that?
Well, for one, he's from Jarvis Street, which is per se a hood within my hood. They never claimed Athens and they never recycled. So all of them are old cats now. And
right.
He used to be in apartments here and there, you know, like pulling up, going to the clubs or whatever the case may be, smoking chronic or whatever the case may be. And at that time, I was 18. I couldn't get in clubs. But his family owned clubs, and he had a pool and stuff within the club community or whatever. So I was able to ride with him and get in the clubs for free. Well, not even for free, not even being carded. You know what I'm saying? Just walk on in the damn club. And people looking like, and I've been to the club, like, flamed up, like, khaki zone, white beater. And people in the club looking like, who is she? I used to have people ask me, like, who are you? Do you rap or stuff? Because, mind you, this is a dope club. What was the name of that club? The Current Affair. Over there off of Manchester and Eucalyptus or whatever. And so this is a dope club. This is not even like an 18 over, 21 over. Mostly everybody is in this club. It's like maybe in the late 30s, 40s, you know, and I'm up in here looking like a little gangbanger, you know. So that's what was one of the things that I guess I would say was intriguing to me, that I was able to do things that I shouldn't be able to do at my age. And we were just cool for like maybe 7-8 months. And then we started to be with each other. And I would say maybe 3 months later, I was pregnant with my daughter. So
wow.
And that's how that started, from that to from 19 years old, basically, to 30 is when I left. So I was with him 11 years, maybe like 2 or 3 months short of 11 years. And he's the father
right,
of my
right.
three kids.
Right. And being the father of your three kids, like I said, again, it wasn't like this was a fling or you just kicked it. You were together for many years. What do you think of? Obviously, it turned bad at the end, but it was obviously some good parts and good times. What do you think, or do you think the age difference, him playing a part in your life, was more so like also a lover, but a friend someone you looked up, like being that he was older, I'm sure he could teach you things and do a lot of different things. So would you say more so it was like a not a father figure, but somebody you could really look up to as well, you know what I mean, as well as being your boyfriend or whatever.
Right. I see it as a blessing in a lot of ways because I could have had a different baby daddy, you know what I mean, and been out there in the streets fighting with him, you know, just young people stuff or just whatever the case may be. But with being with him, I didn't have to worry about that. You know, we wasn't fighting, and, you know, he ain't never beat my ass up or nothing like that. Now, he just slapped the shit out of my ass one time, and that was all it took. But it wasn't turmoil like that. It was just basically what I would say, that he kind of took me out of the gang life, but my daughter actually changed my mind about it, and we just kind of grew apart. You know, it was things that I wanted to do once I turned about like 28 years old, and it was things that I wanted to do, and every time I would speak on it, it would be something like, oh, no, you don't need to do that. You know, I've been there. I've done that. So it was kind of like not shielding me, but it was like suppressing what I wanted to do. And by 30 years old, I was like, you know what? I'm done. Like, I'm done with this. Like, you've done whatever it is you've done in your life, but you don't want me to do anything. And my thoughts before I left was, I'm not going to cheat. I've never cheated on anybody in my life. I don't even get down like that. But I'm not going to cheat. I'm not going to do nothing that's going to bring harm to the house. I'm not going to turn up and be super blood or nothing like that. So why are you tripping? You know what I mean? But I guess maybe it was insecurities or whatever the case may be, by him being so much older than me and by me just now starting to see myself. Because we'll put it as far as like the 19 to, so we'll say maybe like 27. It was more, you know, boo-boo. But I was working and doing everything like that on a positive note, but I hadn't started to see myself. You know what I'm saying? So about 28 to 30, it's like, okay, now I want to wear a dress. You know what I'm saying? I want to press my hair, which I've always had long hair, what have you. So it's like I'm starting to see myself. And I don't know if that was like an insecurity where he started tripping, and then now we're like oil and water. And we're arguing about stuff that don't even need to be argued about, because, I mean, if I want to go to the club with my homegirl, then damn it, I should be able to go to the club with my homegirl. Like, you know, I'm still young, and it was just always an issue. So what I would do is just not go. You know what I'm saying? I prefer to be home with no issues than to go out and here we go 2-3 days not talking because you mad because I went to the club. So it was a lot of things that I couldn't do, which may have saved me from other shit. So I would just say, like, it's a blessing, but at the same time, now here it is, all these years later, I don't respect him. I don't respect him as a person. I don't respect him as a father. I don't respect him as a man. Here saying this today.
Okay. All righty. Well, let me ask you that, piggybacking on all of that, what you just said. This is my next question. Do you think, as well as it being a gift and a curse, like you said, a good and a bad, do you think even though as well as first it was good because, you know, he was older, helped you mature, showed you things you've never seen, you know, helped you grow up, and I'm sure that helped you mature. But do you think later on that had a part, kind of like what you just said, a part in you guys' disconnection because now you are the age gap starts to play. You know, he's older. You're just now coming into womanhood, really, really. You know what I mean? And now you definitely have different opinions, disagree on a lot of things. So you think that played a big part in the disconnection in you two growing apart as the years went on?
Yeah, that played a big part because I feel like if he would have just let me be me, you know what I'm saying, explore with, I wouldn't say his permission, but with his blessing. You know what I mean? I wasn't finna stray away. Because my thing was, I want 3 kids. I wanted 2 boys and a girl. It came the other way, but that's all I wanted. You know what I'm saying? So I wasn't looking for nobody else. It wasn't I wanted a younger man. It wasn't none of that going on in my head, but I don't know what was going on in his head. So it was like that separation because the things that I want to do, like, for example, go to the summer jam. We never went to the summer jam, and I've always wanted to go. But yet, if it's something like his boat and riding to Catalina Island, you know, we can do things like this, but these are the things that you like to do. But we're not doing anything that I like to do. So it's like, you know what, I can't keep doing this on top of different other issues within a home as well.
Right. And I understand. That's why I want to ask you that, because I'm sure that played a big part. And, you know, later on, with any relationship, you know, as time goes on and you're together so long, people start to disconnect or have different opinions. But I want to ask you that because being that you had such a big age gap, you know, I'm sure that plays a big part because now you're growing up, growing into the womanhood and want to do different things. And I'm sure his opinions were different, and he sees that too as well. So I'm sure he did feel a certain way. You know what I mean? You ain't the same little mama fool. He can, you know, you're a woman. So, you know, I just wanted your perspective on that. And what would you say would be like the real, it was to a point, like you said, you were done. You moved out, you know, started all over. You know what I mean? And this was something your kids maybe didn't appreciate because they were young. But what was the breaking point for you to just say, I'm done? You know what I mean? I'm going to move forward and whatever, and take that risk and chance of, you know, starting over and just jumping out there on your own.
Well, it was a couple of things. One thing, it was his kids. And I wouldn't say it in a complete negative manner, but by him being so much older than me, he have 2 daughters that's like a year younger than me or less than a year younger than me. And me and one daughter in particular used to always get into it, but it was one of those things where she didn't like me because of the age. You get what I'm saying? So he never addressed that. And I used to tell him, like, you know, you need to bring me and her to the round table. And if need to be, you need to check both of us. You know what I'm saying? But you need to put your daughter in line, because my thing about it is I don't want to fight your daughter and then still be laying up with you. That's not going to happen. You know what I'm saying? And that was the negative part with that. And another thing is it was just too much of me doing everything pertaining to the kids by myself, and you're here. No difference in certain times my daughter had programs at school where she was on honor roll. She's been on honor roll since elementary. He would stay home, which the school was walking distance, like right down the street. And he would stay home, and we would go to her award ceremony and then come back, and then now he's ready to get up and go do what he going to do. But it's like you was just in the bed asleep while you didn't come down there with me to celebrate, you know, our daughter with her award ceremony. And then other things with Bozy. He used to always want to go with his daddy because his daddy do construction, and, you know, Bozy is like Bob the Builder. And it was a lot of times that he would tell our son when he was like 7, 8 years old, you know, go to sleep, and in the morning you're going to go to work with me. And he would never do it. So it's like I'm fighting you to be a daddy to these kids that we live with. So it was just too much. You know what I'm saying? On top of any and everything that I wanted to do, it was like, oh, nah, you know, like basically like hating on any and everything I want to do, and then you're not helping me with these kids. So it was like I was there and he was there for 11 years consistently. It wasn't on off and on. It wasn't none of that. But it just started to, I started to notice the same man that you are with your other kids, you're being like that with my kids. And it was getting on my nerves. You know what I'm saying? Like, why you can't take your son to go with you to build a back house on somebody's house when this is what he do anyway? He have a gift, a God-given gift. You don't have to teach him really this. You just got to nurture it. And he wouldn't do it. So that was a lot of the fights with, you know what I'm saying, like, why you don't deal with your son? And you right here.
Right.
So it was just too much. And my thing was, you know what? I had got to a point where maybe 6 months before I left, I stopped arguing. Well, I probably stopped arguing like 2 years prior. But within the last 6 months, I was just really calm within myself. Like, and I used to tell him, like, I'm not scared to leave you no more. Because prior to that, I was scared. You know what I'm saying? I'm coming from my mama house to being with you with three kids now. So I'm really not trying to leave, because what I'm going to do, go back to my mama house, and that's what I'm not going to do. So it just came to a point, like, I'm not scared to leave you no more. And I don't know how he took that. He would just look at me when I said, nah, I just said and just going about my little business. You know, I'm content with myself. So it came to a point, and I left. Like, I'm just done. And I left, packed my shit, and I ain't been back.
That's interesting.
And that was a whole lot of stress on my kids. You get what I'm saying?
Sure,
that was a whole lot of stress on my kids. Because it was like we going from a house to apartment, what I call a hamster cage. You know what I mean? And now all the activities and all the Bob the Builder stuff that my son is doing in the backyard, he's over here with these kids, and these kids acting like, for a minute, my son was something like, you know, kids that don't, that another kid is a little bit different from, they act like, oh, it's something wrong with him because he like building stuff, you know, with whatever he get his hands on, he's outside building stuff. And other kids is like, why are you always doing that? You know, because they running around being babies, and my son wasn't one. You know what I'm saying? But ain't nothing wrong with him. He's Bob the Builder. You know what I mean? He want to collect spiders. He want to collect lizards. But y'all scared to touch it, but he's not. So it was like I went through that transition with him feeling like don't nobody really like him or don't nobody understand him. And then at the same time, with my daughter being 9 years old, she's mad. I'm talking about for maybe a year or two. She was mad at me because what she seen was mama broke the house up. She wasn't old enough to put it into perspective why I left. It was just you left. You the reason that we're not together. So it was a lot.
Right. Right. Let me ask you this. When you left, like, I know it was hard to do, but you did it. You know, how was, you just spoke about him not, I guess, not taking it serious. But how was his really, really real reaction once you really did leave and you left and you packed up, you left, got your own spot? Did he try to do better or get you back or you know what I mean? Try
oh,
or was
God.
It just, how was that after that post aftermath
damn.
Of you moving out?
The aftermath was, shoot, let me see. Let me put it in line. I left. I was still working 11 at night to 7 in the morning. So the kids that originally stayed with him because they were still in school right down the street, Beyonce and Bozy. So for maybe about 2 weeks, I would come over like either every day or the nights that I had off, I would pick my kids up and take them to my cousin's house where I was staying. So it came about maybe like 2 or 3 weeks after I left, he had said something to me like, you know, you can come move back here so I don't have to be worried about you and the kids. And I'll move all the cars. I'll move everything out the garage. But mind you, this house is his father's house. So my thing is, I'm like, my words to him over the phone was, you know, I don't trust you. You know, never mind. I'm just going to go on and figure out and get my own apartment. His thing, I guess, of trying to get me back was the very next day, him and the three kids went to the court building. And he got a restraining order against me and put the kids in it, saying that I threatened him with a gun, which to this day I've never done that. So it was like you're trying to use, you know what my kids mean to me, and you know that if you take them from me, then I'm going to have to come back. But wrong. What I did was I stuck it out for 3 weeks and didn't see my kids because I didn't want them to see me and get emotional because they couldn't come around me, like talking about, because it was a restraining order and their names was listed as well. So I just had to stay away. And, like, I think I was a breath away from the crazy house around that time. And went to court or whatever, and, of course, the judge didn't hear that. You know, so that, I guess that was his way of trying to get me back. And during the restraint order time, I had talked to the kids over the phone, and he made a comment, was like, Nakisha, I'm not trying to keep you from your kids. And I'm like, in my mind, like, that's exactly what the fuck you trying to do. I'm not going to come back over there and you put me in a trick trap.
Right.
So, but I was hearing words around the neighborhood or whatever that he wanted family back, whatever, but that's not the way to do it, by lying on me and getting a restraining order.
Mm.
So I've been through some real fuck shit.
Right, right.
But I didn't bite.
I'm sure.
Like I say, I didn't bite. I just did what I needed to do. And within the time of the restrainer, I got my own apartment. I had left. And I probably was gone on, not probably, I know the exact time frame was a month and 9 days, and I had my own apartment. So we went to court, and he's saying things like she living from pillow to post and trying to drag my kids through the street, and I gave the judge my rental agreement. This is where I'm at. And I had moved none of my furniture in my house, my apartment at all. I waited until I got my kids, and we moved in.
Mm. Mm. Okay. Okay, so now you have really, really moved out, you know what I mean? You're out of that relationship. Now, how is it for Mama Boo now, the new Mama Boo? You've got a new life. You're outside of your relationship. You're single. You know what I mean? You got your kids. I'm sure it's not easy at all. You got your own apartment. You went from a house to an apartment, like you said, a hamster cage. How was this transgression? And how, you know, I'm sure it affected everybody, the kids, you, stress, all of that. But you pushed through it, you know, being a strong woman that you are. Take us through this part now when Mama Boo is a new woman now. You know, you're outside of your relationship. You're starting brand new. How does all of this affect you, like getting your womanhood back, being a woman that you are, getting your swag, your confidence, everything to get back out here and be the woman that you are, being that you were just in this relationship for 11 years from a kid to now you are a fully grown woman with three kids and out here. You know what I mean? Take us through that part, because I'm sure it wasn't easy.
That part was highly stressful, highly stressful, because I didn't have no help. So my rent, bills, everything, car insurance, life insurance, everything was on me. From coming from where I didn't pay rent, you know what I mean, and I just paid my bills. Now I have everything to pay. So that was really stressful, to where I had a job that I was working maybe 6 days a week, 12 hours a day. And to put it in perspective, when I left, Mr. was 3 years old. So I have a three-year-old that I don't see no more, really like talking about, you know, where I wake up about 6 in the morning and my cousin lived in an apartment maybe like two doors down. So I would wake up in the morning, take the kids down there to her, you know, and she would drop Beyonce and Bozy off at school. And then I believe about that year or two, Mr. started Head Start. So, you know, she was doing everything for me. But it was very stressful because I would wake my baby up to take him down the way. And then by the time I get off work at get back to the house, maybe about 7:45, 8 o'clock, he's asleep. You know what I'm saying? So it was a lot that I didn't see him, and that really, really affected me more than anything else, that I didn't see him a lot. On top of my older two, but they was bigger. You know what I'm saying? By the time I get home, they still a little vibrant. Time for them to, you know, get in the tub and go to bed or whatever. But we have this baby that I've never been apart from my kids like this, and I don't even talk to you throughout the day because I have to work, because I have to pay these bills, because your daddy not giving us 10 cents. So it affected me in different ways, to where one thing that I don't really too much talk about is, I say maybe the first 6 months or something like that, I would wake up crying a lot, like wake up and not aware that I'm crying. And I would get up, maybe go to the bathroom, whatever, and then I can hear myself cry and then look in the mirror and I'm crying. But I didn't know I was crying. So I was, like I say, I was a breath away from the mental institution. But it was one of those things where it affected me, but my only drive at that time was I will never go back to them, so I have to keep it moving. You know what I'm saying? I have to provide for them. I have to, because I'm not going back to them. So with all the the emotions that I was going through. It was just one of those things like, let me stick to myself and not involve another man or nothing like that in my life, because my emotions is fucked all the way up and I need to figure out who I am as a single mom that I've never ever been.
Right.
So
right.
It was a lot.
Right. Right. Let me ask you this, right? Going through all of this stress and these hard times, did you ever consider, or I'm sure you worked a lot of jobs, different jobs, or the job you had, and it was stressful. Did you ever consider, you know what I mean, being that you had your ties to the streets and the neighborhood, going back or getting involved in different things to get money or whatnot, or were you even involved still with any other neighborhood activities, being that you pretty much transgressed from that with your kids and your life and all that? Was it ever a time that you were thinking about trying to do some different things, or were you even still involved with any of your homeboys or homegirls, and did they help you at this time going through all of your problems?
I would say I really didn't think about, you know, doing anything that would get me caught up or risk anything with my kids. So I never thought outside of actually working, you know, doing it the right way. Yes, I was still connected. You know, I wasn't active, but at this point, I was doing a lot of drinking. So I would be turned up, ready to fight, but I wasn't active.
Right.
You get what I'm saying? I was doing a lot of, like I say, drinking or whatever at that time. But I never did tell anybody what was going on. No difference than, just for example, like I keep alluding to, it was something going on at the end of last year that I have not talked about. You know what I mean? But on the outside looking in, people don't see it, you know, because you just see me and I'm not saying it or whatever. So people really didn't know what was going on because I wasn't speaking to nobody. I had one person that I called Pumpkin. I used to always talk to her and tell her everything. So she was like my counselor for that time frame, but I really didn't tell nobody what was going on. I never reached out for help. I've never been one to ask nobody to do anything for me to begin with, because I've never had nobody to do something for me. So I've never been that type to feel comfortable enough to ask. So I never really told nobody what was going on. I was just stressing and just keeping it pushing, just being resilient, you know. I just had to keep it pushing, and I had a tight lid on what was going on, and I didn't want people to know what was going on, which I probably should have said something now looking back, because now that I've stepped into, you know, telling my testimony, it feels way better than when I was going through that and wasn't saying nothing. So, but no, didn't nobody help me. Didn't nobody help me. I would say, matter of fact, I wouldn't say didn't nobody. My mom helped me as far as in me being able to drop my kids off over there if need to be, for me to go to work or whatever the case was, when my cousin wasn't doing it or whatever. So my mom helped me, but it was a whole lot that I kept from my mom, all while the restraining order was out for the 3 weeks. I didn't even tell my mama. So it was just a lot of times I don't talk about what's going on. I just, you know, go within myself inside my head and try and figure it out myself. And so far, so good.
Right. Let me ask you one more thing about your mom. We spoke about it earlier. I don't want to keep going back to that, because you spoke about how the relationship is. But what about your kids? What is their relationship with their grandmother and that part? Briefly, I want to speak on that.
They love their granny.
Okay. That's good. That's great. That's all I wanted to hear.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, we'll leave that alone. And what else I wanted to ask you was this, right? Going through all of this, what was the changing point or the life-turning event in your life that got you on a different path as far as, okay, I'm done with this stress? When did it take a turn to where it got better for you?
When I started going to college. So once I started
speak about that.
It was in between working, you know, all them hours, and then I attended University of Phoenix, so I would go to class once a week. So it was that, and then, you know, me doing homework and exercising my brain, you know what I'm saying, learning new words. And I don't know if, I mean, people out there in the G-Lew land, y'all know you go to college, is that the questions are not how can I put it? The questions are not simple questions. Like, for you to answer this question, you really got to, like, know what the question is and define it yourself, because it kind of, like, alludes to what you need to be talking about, but it's not like a kid. Like, what is 2 + 2 or what did the dog say? It's maybe a question that's, like, you know, with the pros and cons in it or whatever, and you got to, like, figure it out. So with me doing that exercise in my brain, that was a lot of what kept me, what would I say, growing, you know, and kind of feeling better about myself. Like, oh, okay, I finished that homework. Okay, I got a B, you know, oh, I got an A, you know. And through college, coming from a kid that was not able to read and write on her level, once I got to college, after I left baby daddy or what have you, I had started reading books while I was with him. Like Donald Goins, I've read all his books. The Coldest Winter Ever, Sister Soldier. It's a lot of books that I've read. And as well as when I was with my daughters, maybe like 4 or 5 months, I started going to school for medical assistant. So I taught myself how to read by reading to her. So throughout the years, I would read books, you know what I'm saying? And like, you know, just educate myself, or, you know, just amplifying my vocabulary or whatever, my comprehension or whatever. And then once I got to college, with me seeing them B's or maybe a C here and there and an A, like a freaking A, you know, so it was like I was geeking myself up, you know.
Right.
So that kind of brought me out a little bit from being so depressed, because I was seeing growth in myself, that it wasn't nothing I was sharing with anybody. It was just me going through it myself and seeing the response as far as in my grades or whatever. And it's like, okay, bitch, you ain't that stupid. Okay, you smart, girl, you smart. So that helped a whole lot.
Right. I want to ask you, what prompted you even to want to go to college or start taking classes? How did that happen in the first place?
My little cousin, mm-hmm. when she's a year younger than me, she started maybe 6-7 months before I did, and she lived, well, her sister lived down the way. And she was just talking to me one day. She was like, girl, if you go to college, you know, you only got to go to school once a week. Like, you could pull that off and do the little 4 years, woot-woot-woot. And I'm like, I don't know. Like, I'm working 6 days a week, 12-hour shifts. Like, girl, I'm not trying to be going to school. And she like, you should do it. And she started. So it was like, okay, mm-hmm. it was one of those things, a positive monkey see, monkey do.
Mm-hmm. Wow. And you doing that, I'm sure, changed your life. So I'm sure you were grateful for that. Now, I want to ask you, how was that, even you starting to go to school now, how was that whole process? Because, like you said, I'm sure it wasn't easy. I'm sure there was times you wanted to quit, you know, do all this. What made you get through it all and get through that process? And then how did it feel to graduate and now I'm done and now I can have a career?
It was scary. Because with every class, the class is 5 weeks, and then you're on to a different course. Mm-hmm. So I would say 98% of all the classes, by the fifth week, you have to get up and do a team presentation. So that was like the scariest thing, with talking in front of people. Now, don't get me wrong. I grew up going to church, and I've always did the welcome, speak on the theme, all that. But once I got to college and I had to stand up, I used to be so nervous. I'm still nervous now talking to people. I'm nervous right now talking to you. But it was more of the fear of that I'm going to get up there and boo-boo going to start talking versus Nakisha going to start talking. So I would be like just so scared. And it was an older lady in the class. And I used to always tell her, like, oh, my God, I do not want to get up. And she used to be like, I can't wait till you get up and talk. Like, I come to see you talk. Like, I cannot tell that you're scared. And I'm like, feel my hands. My hands used to be cold and sweaty. And she'd be like, girl, go on and get up there and make me laugh. For whatever reason, people think I'm funny. And I'd be like, dead fucking serious. So it was a scary thing, but I got better and better at it. But I never got to where I was comfortable with speaking in front of the class with the team. Even though, looking at it, I wasn't one of the ones that be like, okay. You know how people say different things when they nervous? I don't too much do that. I may start laughing or something like that, or I may kind of crack a joke or something like that. But looking at it, it was like, okay, I'm not as bad as this person. I can actually convey what it is that I want you guys to hear, opposed to getting stuck and being like, so it was a process. It was a process. And then after I got to where I graduated, that was March of last year. And me and the kids went out to Arizona, and I graduated out there at Arizona, University of Phoenix, the convention center or what have you, and me, the kids, and two of my close friends and their niece. So we all drove out there, and, I mean, it felt like, finally, like another hurdle I done jumped over, another accomplishment. You know, like, if nothing else, my kids have to, they have to do something. They have to be some. They have to be somebody and do something because your mother is a college graduate. You know what I mean? So it's like I set the bar for them. And a lot of my drive was because of my kids, because they're watching me. And then what I'm going to do is sit around and tell the story of, you know, your mom was a gangbanger. That ain't cute. Ain't nothing cute about that. So it's like I need to prove to myself as well as prove to them that it's bigger and better things and more positive things out there. And they felt the vibe of their mama walking the stage. That's their second time seeing me walk the stage. I've walked the stage before with my CNA license years ago. I think Mr. was maybe like, Mr. was a lap baby. So Mr. could have been like 2 to 3, 4 months old. So Beyonce and Bozy have seen me walk the stage before. But this one was harder to do. You know, CNA license, you can get that in like 2-3 months, you know, versus 4 years, which I turned it into like damn near 5.5 years to walk the stage. So, you know, it's an accomplishment. They saw their mama do it. And then last year, Beyonce graduated from high school honor roll. And then Mr. graduated from elementary. So we would just graduate. We were just walking the stage in 2019.
Right. It's a beautiful thing. That's a beautiful thing right there. You know, to accomplish what you accomplished, and then now see your kids just accomplish what they are doing, graduate, and your daughter's about to go on to the Navy, I mean, to the Air Force, and you got another son, I'm sure will graduate soon, and it's just a beautiful thing. How do you feel that if you feel any, as your life has changed since you made that accomplishment, you know, getting your degree and things of that nature? How has your life changed now? How do you feel, you know, since doing that?
What a lot of that has taught me is if I put my mind to it, I can do it, because I've proven to myself when I didn't think I could do it. So my life has changed as far as, and I'm not scared of myself no more. I've been a lot of, in the past, with anything positive or projecting myself out there for someone to have an opinion about what I said or what I've done, I used to care about that. Now I don't care about that, because I am who I am and I'm going to be who I be. If you like it, you like it. If you don't, scoot over, move over. So with all the things that then happened to me, and like my daughter said to me maybe a month ago, we was talking about something, and she was like, "Mommy, you know how a baby will fall on their face? And you know the baby is hurt, and the baby will just get up and walk away like there's nothing wrong with the baby." She was like, "Mama, that's how you are." And I didn't know what to take with that. I'm like, I don't know if I want to be mad at you, little girl, or did you just say something good to me? But in thinking about what she said, she keeps seeing me fall on my face in certain aspects of what it is that life keep bringing to me, but I get up without crying and just keep it moving like it never happened. So my thing to her is, you got that same strength. I mean, at
that's
this point,
deep.
I mean, I'm just getting over being scared of myself. And I'm really not too much scared of myself no more. I just really don't care what it is that people think. It's like, I'm going to put it out there. This is me. I'm with the positive. If you got this negative going on, please stay away from me, because I'm not playing with nobody. And I'm definitely not playing about my kids or with my kids.
That part. Now, being that you said that, right, let me talk about this. Let's switch gears a bit, right? Now we have Mama Boo, you know, a college graduate, grown woman, you know, into her own, kids are growing up. How long does it take you, you know, to find inside of yourself, you know, who I am as a beautiful, young, strong black woman, you know, attractive? I'm sure all the homies be at you over the years, but you're strong. Like, you don't you know, you don't fall for the okie doke or none of the bullshit. But how long or when does it, you know, come to a point where, okay, Mama Boo, need to get Mama Boo back, and where does that come into play? How does that come into play? How do you judge men? Are men intimidated by you, which I'm sure they are? You know, how does it go for Mama Boo now? Get Mama Boo back, getting her groove back, as they say, or whatnot. You know what I mean? We gotta get into this now. You know what I mean? Because I know it's the sweet side of Mama Boo. She hard as a motherfucker, but inside it's a Mama Boo. You know, a sweet thing. So, what's going on with Mama Boo right now as far as Mama Boo Boo? You dig?
Well, my thing about it is. My thing about it is, I'm just trying to learn myself all over again on a more potent level, and I know I'm not meant for everybody. I'm very clear of that. I've always been clear of that. So my thing is, I mean, I'm really not ready to even be doing all that. You know what I mean? It's more like my emotions are still a little stirred up from things that went on at the end of the year. So right now it's just me and my kids. You know, I mean, yeah, the line is wrapped around the corner as far as then who trying to holler and whatever. But it is what it is. It eventually happened. But right now I'm just doing Mama Boo. You know, me and the three pimps. Because what I don't want to do, and then my other thoughts about it as well, is I have a lot of things on my plate right now. And I was talking to an advisor, and he had told me, he was like, you shouldn't put more on your plate than what you're ready for. And that's what I've just recently heard maybe a couple of months ago. But I put a gang of stuff on my plate because just trying to just keep working, keep moving with the motorcycle, with, you know, with the nonprofit, with the with a lot of stuff, you know, just the book. You know, it's been a lot of things that I've been having going on, and I've been trying to put a lot of stuff on my plate because my feelings was hurt last year, you know. So at this point, it's like my whole outlook on it now is I need to clean and get some of this shit that's on this plate secured before I can really go to somebody and be like, okay, this is what I got. You know what I'm saying? Like, I need to get more stable with myself and then be more of a whole woman when I step to the next person or the person step to me. You get what I mean? Does that kind of make sense? Because it makes sense like hell in my head.
Nah. What I was going to say, I was going to piggyback on that and say the same thing because I feel the same way in a lot of ways when it comes to that. Like you said, when you've been through so much, you know what I mean? And then at the age that we're at this point, it's like harder to, you know, it's not so much because people will just have a perception or say that you're single. Why are you single? Or won't. When, like you said, it's a lot of times, even now in 2020, a lot of shit is overrated anyway. A lot of relationships ain't what they, that's another part. You see people in relationships are married and they're not happy and a lot of things, and being that you've been through so much and at the point of your life, it's like it's so much stuff you want to accomplish or get together or get situated in your own life before you try to bring that into a relationship. And then when you're been alone, or not alone, but just content with what you do so long, it's like you don't accept anything. You know what I mean? And you ain't even tripping on that. You know, you worried about what you need to do, and all the other shit is secondary because a lot of shit is overrated anyway. So I just want to ask you, what part does that play in your life, and does that equate to you maybe still being single or not tripping on a relationship or not even worrying about that right now?
Yeah, that's exactly what it is. I'm not worried about that right now. You know, I don't want to mix my emotions, which are not settled, with nobody else's emotions. You know, it's just more like I just want to get myself together so I can see who he is for who he is without having a conflict of my hurt, my anger to, you know, mess it up or to be aggressive or to be overly mean or be too cautious or to be someone that don't really trust people. You know, let me just get my shit together before I step into a relationship with number three.
Mm-hmm.
Period.
Right. And that's big. You said number three, so that means you ain't even see. That's what I'm talking about. But on a different note, you know, how is it though when dealing with all this, not tripping on no relationship or none of that shit? How is it though still, you know, when Mama Boo get lonely and stuff? We, you know, it's like You know, how do you deal with that part of the game and the stress, or are you just over it? You know what I mean? How was that? Because you're still a woman. You know, you have emotions and pleasures and things you know, like needs and all of this. So how was that for a beautiful young woman as yourself to deal with amongst all the BS?
I don't deal with it. I don't even be tripping like that. To be honest, I don't trip. And then once I'm home, you know, I have other things to do. I have a 18-year-old daughter that loves to talk to me and tell me about her day. You know, she's been doing this all in high school. Every day, come talk to me. So I have 3 people up in my house that if I need to occupy my time, I can go play with them, go bother them, or go and mother them. Other than that, I have this book. Or prior to the book, you know, it'll just be like, you know, just sitting there listening to different stuff, inspiring videos on YouTube, and take my ass to sleep and get up the next day and do it again. Like, I don't even really be tripping off of that. Like, honestly, that don't even be nothing that I even be tripping about. Now I would say maybe here and there, like, say, for example, yesterday was Valentine's Day. Yesterday, me and my daughter went out so I can go ball her up in basketball because she swears she good. But anyway, so it was just one of those things like I wish, you know what I'm saying? But that's as it go. I'm cool because if I really wished and really wanted it, oh, I could have made it happen. But I'm cool.
Right.
I'm cool.
I'm sure of that. And I also want to ask you, on top of that, how do you avoid the bullshit, though? Like when times you may get lonely, not even lonely, or just, you know, like I'm sure it's a gang of niggas that want to holler at you. It's wrapped around the corner. You get niggas this, that, here, trying to holler or whatever. How do you avoid the bullshit and say, okay, you know what I mean? Oh, this nigga may be cool or cute or think you may, or start having conversations and avoid getting caught up. You know what I mean? Do you have a radar? Is it some things you've been through so much where you could avoid that or know when the nigga ain't right for you or whatnot? Because I'm sure it's a lot of niggas that get at you. You know what I mean? And again,
well,
you know, sometimes
you
may like a dude or something. How do you have to deal with that, being you know, who you are? And now it's just you a, like, low-key celebrity as well.
How do I deal with that? Now I may have conversations if I'm bored or something like that, or if I have time for it, but for the most part, it just doesn't bother me. Like, it just really don't bother me because I'm still getting over hurt. So if that make any sense, you know what I'm saying? Like, some women that I do know, they go through whatever it is they go through, and they lash out at you. They need somebody to comfort them or whatever. My best comfort is me, and I've always been like that. So that registers back to childhood with not having nobody to talk to me, you know, not having nobody to really be on me about school, or no difference when my daddy passed away. I never had nobody to talk to me, so I'm more so content with being with myself. I don't feel that I'm a woman that have to have a man around me. I would like one eventually, but I ain't tripping off that. He gonna come, and when he come, boom, ping, pow.
Right, and I can agree because I feel the same way. And a lot of everything you just said, I kind of live my life the same way. Again, do you think maybe what you just said, that eventually it will happen? You know, when it's supposed to. But I was gonna ask you, do you think being what you've been through and the lasting effects that it has on you, maybe, you know, or may or may not cause you for not to be happy again, or to find the perfect person, not the perfect person, but what you prefer, because now you have what you like and what you don't like. You've been through a lot. You see the bullshit. Do you think it's harder, especially in 2020, when a lot of people are on a lot of bullshit and a lot of things are just not real anymore? It's a lot of bullshit out here, social media and, you know, all of this shit that makes it harder to know somebody to be the person they really are, opposed to what they put on and what you think they are.
I don't think it's going to be hard at all. You know, I believe there are still a gang of good men out there. And my thing about that is the man kind of responds to you of how you treat yourself. So I don't have none of those worries about thinking that, will I meet the right one or whatever the case may be. My thing is, first and foremost, I cannot be a bitter bitch. So I cannot allow myself to be a bitter bitch going into a relationship and want him to be the king and the stars and the moons and the sun when I'm over here a bitter ass bitch. So with that being said, I have to get myself together on all levels. whether it's emotionally, spiritually, physically, mentally. I have to line up my core. So when I come correct. And when I come correct, I'm going to be able to sense your ass not correct because I don't have no distractions of my bullshit in the back of my head. So I believe it's going to happen. So I'm not worried about it. I'm actually almost excited for whenever it do happen. Because I'm going to be turned all the way up and turned on. I'm just trying to line up my core right now.
Okay.
Because I know I'm something special. I'm clear about that.
Right, right, that part. That you are. So, Boo, you know, we talked about all of the past and all of that things, you know, in your past. What molded you to be who you are, how you are? How you get on, how you interact, how you address people, you know. Tell us what's going on now, because you wear a lot of hats. You know, you've recently started to let out your life story. You know what I mean? Things about your personal life. You know, you've exposed that now. Now you got a lot of other things going on. You work with a lot of different people. You know, shout out to the homie Cree. I know you're doing a lot of things with him. You know, you're from a well-known area, neighborhood, and Free Creek area, and, you know, your story has been out there. A lot of doors are opening. A lot of different things are happening in your life. Tell us what's going on right now with Mama Boo, you know, with all of these things going on, and where do you see the journey going now?
Right now, my major thing is to finish my book, because that book is going to take me to the stars. My other thing is being an actress over here on the side. There's a lot of things that I do, like through central casting or what have you, that I don't put on social media. Me and Cree have a project coming up, a short film by the name of Karma, and I will be starring in that. Other than that, the motorcycle club, I haven't been really too much on my motorcycle because I've been having so much other stuff going on, but I'm not really tripping off of that per se right now because the patent is patent. You know what I'm saying? Can't nobody take that from me. So whenever I do start doing whatever it is out there on the bike set, then it is what it is. I'm not really in pressure of getting that up and running or getting the girls, because I have one, but I'm not really tripping too much right now because this book is my main focus and my kids is my main focus. So with that being said, I mean, I have other stuff going on, but it's one of those things where I've talked so much about what I have going on to where I'm under pressure now of delivering it. So that's where I'm at right now.
Right.
I'm on delivery now. So that's all that I'm talking about these days is that book and then that new film, the short film. Other than that, the nonprofit and everything, all that's in the making, in the mix, right where I'm, where, you know, it's going. But I don't want to too much talk about it because I want to show and tell. Show instead of just keep telling it.
Right, right. And you spoke about the book. I want to talk about the book. What is the book about? When can we expect it? And I also want to ask you, now that you've been out there telling your story to the world, you've been on Street Games, which is a big platform, big numbers you had. I'm sure it's a lot of, like I said, a lot of different doors opening. Have you been able now to connect with different people? Like, I recently seen you at an event with the homegirl from Looters, Miss Nunn. You know, have you been able to connect with different people in different neighborhoods? Or do you have anything going on as far as that? Part of the, you know, of what you're doing now?
Oh, yeah, I've connected with a lot of people, no different than, thanks to you, I've connected with Dee Dee Harrison, and shout out to her, prayers, condolences, and love going out to her. So I reached out to her. She told me a whole lot. She basically got my back as far as anything that I need to help me as far as in a book, because if you guys don't know, Dee Dee Harrison, she's the author herself. So I've spoken to her. It's been a lot of people, no different than Sylvia. She was letting me know that with her nonprofit, she'd be getting people, you know, to want her to come out, fly out to a different state to talk to the girls. But she was letting me know, you know, she's a little bit fearful of speaking in public. So with me talking to her that day, I'm like, if they call you, call me, because I love to run my mouth. And then another thing as far as in with Dee Dee as well, at some point, she's going to hook me up with some people to where I can go and talk to the kids, like in a detention center. So that's one of the things that I'm actually looking forward to. And I've actually submitted different little emails to the different detention centers around here so I can go speak to the young girls. So different stuff like that. Like, y'all is going to start seeing so much of that damn Mama Boo. And, of course, the lady from Sweden, I had an interview with her, what was that, last weekend? So I'm waiting for her to put the video up and actually hopefully put me in a newspaper out there in Sweden. So, you know, going trying to go overseas with it, just speaking my testimony, saying what it is.
Right, right. That's a beautiful thing. That's the good part about all of this, what you're doing, the work you're doing. It's opening a lot of doors for you to expand and, you know, let your voice be heard. With that being said, I want to ask you too briefly. We spoke about Miss Cynthia Nunn and all the things she's doing in a lot of different outlets. I want to ask you, what do you think about being that you're a woman from this original gang shit? What do you think about what's going on right now, current day with the gang activity and all that? Because there's a lot of things that have shifted, but it's a lot of things that are still going on. Good and bad, you know. On top of that, we have a lot of changes in a lot of different neighborhoods, gentrification, all of these things which play a part. On top of that, the youngsters is a different generation than what you grew up from and what you, the morals and respects and the things you stood on. What do you think about what's going on right now, 2020, you know, and the whole aspect of the gang culture, not only your neighborhood but abroad in Los Angeles? And what do you think about the future of it, and what do you think you can do to help or not help or just speak now that you have the outlet that you have to help younger homegirls or homeboys?
Well, what I think about what's going on is I'm really not involved, and I don't be around to see actually what really be going on anymore because I choose not to. But I just see a lack of structure, you know, and my thing about it is you got the police killing us. You know what I'm saying? It's a lot of other people that – that's waiting for our demise, and yet we're around here killing each other as well, you know. And I'm not innocent as far as in that type of mindset, but it's one of those things where it's like, come on, young men, you know what I'm saying? If nothing else, stop killing each other, because the police doing that, you know what I mean? Like, we don't need to help them. And as far as in females, it's females, I'm finna reach out to their ass. I mean, that right there, that's inevitable. That's gonna happen. I'm going to change some mindsets. That's a point blank period. So,
right.
I mean, everything to me is really going to the worst because it's lack of structure, it's lack of respect, it's lack of self-respect, it's a lot of witchcraft going on, it's demonic forces out here. Then you got these demonic drugs. So it's a lot of shit just going on that's like really like y'all really like getting ready for the end of the world the way y'all doing what y'all doing. You're not taking a step back, not enough. It's taking a step back and helping each other. Everybody is against each other when we got every other race against us. That don't make no damn sense. We the only race that do that. So I just think it's overdue for time for change and not change for 2 months.
Right.
I can't really.
When something happens.
My thing is really not stepping in as far as in the men are concerned. Hopefully they'll hear something and, you know, it may set off a bell with them. But I'm with the women. I'm over here pressing for these young girls with all this prostitution, drugs, and all this shit that they got fucked up. You know, I mean, just go on social media. You see it. You see it. It's like the ancestors would be so fucking hurt. They just turning over in their grave with all the fuck shit that these women got going on. Like, really. It is out of pocket. So, my job, I'm going to reach out to some of them. That's what, I'm going to change some lives. That's my goal, and I believe that's my purpose. And since I've been living in my purpose, doors have been opening. I mean, like how the hell you get hooked up with a lady from Sweden where they can take your story and take it over there, and I'm just boo-boo from Athens. So I see these doors. I see God working, and I'm right there. I'm on the team. I'm working with him.
Right. Let me ask you this one more thing on this, because I heard you speak about this recently on one of your episodes on your show. What I want to get to.
Oh Lord, what I say.
After this as well too. But now I want to, because you were speaking about the neighborhood of people in positions, right? What do you think about people, especially in the state that we're in now, where it's hard for a lot of people in the inner cities and neighborhoods that we grew up in? I heard you speak about this, not only the homeboys from the neighborhoods, but people who are in position to do things to help out. How do you feel about that, being from a, maybe it could be a rapper or a big-time dude from your neighborhood or whoever that has made it and can reach back and does or does not, or do you think they're doing enough? And also, do you think, it doesn't have to be a rapper or anybody, but do you think the times we're in now where we really need it, do you think people in position or celebrities or people that come from the inner cities and still, quote-unquote, maybe represent that, they rappers or they whatever they do, they get on camera and they this and that, but probably not really reaching back to the neighborhood or helping out, whether it be the homeboys or homegirls? Because I heard you speak about that. What do you think about that issue, and what could be done to change that?
I think when it comes to, for example, what you're saying, someone that come up out of the hood, I do not see them reach back to the women, and I really have a problem with that. Because just for example, with things that we see rappers that come up or whatever the case may be, authors or whatever the case may be, they don't really reach back to the women and give them game. You know what I'm saying? You see them pull back and get their homies, and now their homies is, you know, learning how to flip LLCs, or they learning how to flip the money using Instagram or whatever the case may be. You see a gang of niggas doing it, but you don't see them reaching back to maybe one or two or three of their homegirls that's solid little people too. So I think it's very biased. And my thing about it is, you don't have to put, and I want to kind of clear up what I did say on my on Intimate Talk with Mama Boo. I was basically like saying, as far as in videos or whatever, but that's just not the expand that I want. I want it to be more expanded. I mean, as far as in the girls that's going to college or that may be accounting or whatever the case may be, or may want to be an accountant, you can pull her in, help her with whatever it is that she needs to do so she can feed these kids. Because my thing about it is, I see a lot of homies that pull homies in, and these niggas is drinking lean. These niggas is cussing their baby mama out. Some of them taking care of their babies. Some of them are not. But yet the women are mostly, more than likely, all the time stuck with these babies. Pull some of these women and get them in position to be able to do what it is that they need to do to succeed and get ahead of the game so they can get a game to another female. I mean, it shouldn't just be the men doing it. And then my thing about it is, when you see a woman that's doing it, more than likely she did it from the ground by herself. Or may be a chick that had a baby daddy, and he had a little money or whatever the case, and she got game from him. But it's never one of those things like, okay, I went to school where I've been on her since second grade, fifth grade, since whatever, and it's like, I know she's solid. She ain't no punk bitch. You know what I'm saying? She about her money, and I see her struggling. Let me go snatch her and give her the ropes to get some money this type of way, how me and my niggas is doing it. And you may not see her in the video, but she's in the background somewhere handling business for him. Shit, I don't know. Send some of these women to... what is it, security class, bodyguard class, because some of these women can fight better than these niggas. Some of these women got better aim than these niggas. Start getting these big chicks, they can be big or little. Everybody got a solid-ass girl or a few of them in their neighborhood that got hands and that is very aggressive. Pull her ass and let her be your bodyguard. But a nigga don't want a chick to be the bodyguard because it's a chick. But that chick may be more deadlier than the rest of these niggas you got. They just big. So I think it's biased. And I think niggas need to start reaching back to these women and helping these women. First off, we the ones with the kids. Help these kids not just come through the hood once a year with a backpack giveaway. Come get your homegirl and show her how to get some money. I guarantee you her loyalty will be stronger and tougher than the nigga that you fuck with.
Okay. And it's safe to say, you just made a valuable point, though. It's safe to say that most people in positions that got a little money, whatever the case, the best way to give back to your neighborhood is to invest in it. And that means, like she said, I mean, even buying property if you can't do that, but invest in the people in the neighborhood. Send them people, especially the strong ones, you know the strong ones from the Rudy Pools or the people who ain't about nothing, but the ones you know or think have a future or something you can build in them, invest in them, like you said, send them to school to do this, even if it's just security guard or little shit. You know, that goes way further than just coming back, dropping off a sack in the hood or bringing on me to the video or doing this right here for a minimal monetary gain when you can invest in them and make them better. That's what we need now, especially people in positions to do that, because the hood is drying up, the property is drying up, the city is drying up. You know, they're pushing everybody out. It's gentrification at an all-time high. And 5-10 years from now, things will be totally different. So it's time right now to take that position to make things happen, especially people that are in position. Like you said, opposed to just going on Instagram, flashing money, and all of this right here, it's time right now because it's real critical and crucial right now, you know, for people
right.
in position.
Right, and my thing about
it as
little well.
Things to invest.
Right, and stop selling your property. Stop, like, we got that shit so damn bad. So bad. They may offer a home, well, a urban family, $250,000, whatever the case may be for the house, or whatever the case may be, and y'all bite, but then when y'all turn around trying to get another house, your credit not good. So now you stuck.
Mm.
Now you're in an apartment.
Preach.
You know what I'm saying? Because there's a lot
Preach.
That go with that, and it's like, okay, y'all giving away grandma's house, but now your ass is in an apartment because y'all ain't done y'all research. Y'all thinking of this quick money when the money that they give y'all, the house may be worth more than that in 2-3 more years. You know what I'm saying? Well, y'all need to stay y'all ass right there and get your credit together and then flip a house or something like that, opposed to running with this money and now you're trying to get a house and they're like, oh, well, your credit not good. And now you feel like, well, I just, you know, sold a house. You selling that house don't got shit to do with your credit to get another one. So there's a lot of things like that. People not talking to their kids and talking to each other about credit. Credit is like the number one thing that motherfuckers really need to have in motherfucking order to move forward. I don't care about a nigga having fire racks in his damn pocket. That
right.
don't really mean nothing. That don't mean nothing.
Right.
In real reality, in real life, that don't mean nothing. What's your credit score like? Period.
Hey,
motherfuckers just be falling off the bandwagon. They be falling off the bandwagon to get some quick money. And y'all need to stop being so quick to sell granny's property or to sell granny's liquor store or to sell granny's meat market. And you need to keep that in the damn family and get y'all ass up off y'all ass and go and down there and contribute to what granny, grandpa started. Instead of sitting down there fussing and fucking fighting about who driving this car today. Like, come on now. You better start paying attention to other races. They don't act like that. That's why they got something.
And that's the point I'm trying to make, why we need people like you to speak about these things. Because what I was going to ask you next is how does people like in these situations, like you said, probably been living in poverty their whole life or check to check or whatever, and now somebody comes and offers them $250,000 for their house. But like you said, they haven't done the research because they don't know the knowledge on how to do that. And that's what's going on because they prey on these people. But how do you take somebody who's been living in poverty and not getting money to now getting offered $250,000? You know they're going to take it, but the shit is not lined up in order to make the progress to make that $250,000 work for you. So now, like you said, now it's dwindling down, and opposed you get a house, you an apartment, you're back to doing this and this and that, and you fuck off that $250,000. You're back to square one, and mama's house is gone. You know what I mean? How do we change that perception, though, to get the people to know the knowledge to do that, though? Because if somebody comes and offers you $250,000 a day, you're taking it. Most niggas in the hood.
Right. Well, the only way to cure that is the people that educate themselves. They have to want to educate themselves. Because, I mean, like you say, somebody pop up on your doorstep talking about $250,000 and you sitting there don't know nothing about your next move, you don't know how to make your next move your best move, then you basically fucking yourself. But you really fucking yourself by sitting around not educating yourself so your next move can be your best move. So, I mean, it's self-inflicted bullshit, if you ask me. Because why everybody's sitting around talking about what's going on Twitter, what's going on IG, and you're not educating yourself, that's your bad. So you got to get off your ass, read something. I mean, it don't cost nothing to Google nothing.
nothing. That's your
people
friend.
People should be Google experts. They should be like, anytime somebody asks you something you don't know, you should Google it. That simple.
That simple. Google
but
is your friend. 2020.
But you sit there and you talk about something that's going on in social media land. They know all about that. Who broke up? Whose son got makeup on? They know all that. But what is your kids doing? Do you know that?
That part. Hey, Boo. Let me take a quick turn. I got a couple callers want to call in and maybe ask you a question or so. You know, so let me do that if you don't mind.
No problem. Hell yeah. Let them in.
Caller, hello.
Yes, sir. This is Floss the Boss checking in. What's happening?
Big Flossie.
Hey.
What's up, Mama Boo? How y'all doing? I'm calling all the radio shows, checking in. My homegirl Nene having a birthday party, so her and Larry got me out of the house. G-Lew, you know, I don't be in the backyard boogie too much, but it's my folks, so I said she is.
That's right.
I've been at
Uncle
the park.
Larry.
I was at the park today in King Park. And, you know, we was trying to get everybody vote. You know, we trying to get more black people to vote, man. We got to do better, man. You know what I'm saying? So we right. just stopped down in the hood, man, just putting it out there, man. Let's do some vote now. We did everything else. Let's do some vote.
That's right.
But I just called to say,
exactly.
Hey, Mama Boo, and check in and give my shout out, you know. And I'm just, hey, G-Lew,
thank
I'm out
you.
For the night. You know, I'm an old man, nigga. I ain't been out the house past my bedtime, nigga.
That's right.
And I just been calling Hank. Actually, the little get together is right around the corner from Hank's house. I've been calling Hank. It's right down the street from Hank's house. But yeah, I'm just out here supporting my homegirl Nene, you know, for a little birthday. But I'll be in the house before it get too late. You know me. I gotta go relax. But Mama Boo, I'm just giving you a shout out, baby. Keep up the good work.
Thank you.
You know what I mean?
Have a good night.
As a matter of fact, hey, I should have been at that book signing. That's my homegirl that was up there at the book signing with you and shit. I should have pulled up on y'all, but I was working that day. But we're gonna bump heads. We're running each other so we can introduce ourselves.
Okay, looking
for
forward
sure.
to you.
Okay, G-Lew, I get with you later, and we'll get ready for tomorrow, man.
Yes, sir. OG Sundays is going down. Hey, send my love to Nene and Larry, homie.
Yeah, they right here. Yes, sir. Okay, I'll see y'all. I'm going to go live in a minute, G-Lew. So y'all check me out in a minute.
All right, Floss. Much love, homie.
Right on.
Peace. Shout out to Big Flossie, my co-host on OG Sundays with Mama Boo became a part of recently, and she says she loves it, shows love to the show. So thank you for that.
Yes.
That's my partner
in
crime on OG
shout
Sundays.
Shout out to Queen Jean. That's my boo.
Uh-oh.
That's my auntie boo.
Uh-oh.
That's my auntie boo right there. I love me some Queen Jean. That's my boo.
Hey, and she was right on cue because she pressed one right when you said that. So let me bring in Queen Jean so she can show you some love as well. Queen Jean.
What's going on?
Hey.
Mama Boo, queen.
Yes,
queen.
Ma'am.
Thank you for that shout out, but listen, I love you just as much, and I just want to give you a big salute. And you know how I feel because we communicate, but keep on elevating, keep on being inspiring because the young princesses need you to become the queens that they need to be. So keep being that inspirational queen that you are. I admire you. You're very inspirational. And you remind me of me on so many levels. I'm listening to you, and I was like, damn, that sounds like me. Damn, that sounds like me. Damn, that sounds like me. Oh, shit. That sounds like me. So keep doing what you're doing. You know, you're inspirational. Even me in my sixth decade, I can still learn something. And listening to you, I'm learning. You feel me? I hear you. And if I was in Cali, still living in Cali, we would have a big hookup. So I'm going to reach out to some people I know as well that can reach out and touch you where you guys can do things together. And I'll keep you informed on that.
Thank you. You have to have a tearjerker going on over here. Oh, thank you. So appreciate it.
Yeah, and we, you know, thank you for all your support with our show as well, you know. So, listen, I just wanted to say that great interview. Love you. And G-Lew, peace.
Love you, too.
Thank you,
thank
Queen
you.
D.
You're
welcome.
Much love, Queen. Thank you
you
for calling in. Yeah,
right,
you know we'll do it tomorrow night. OG Sundays, Queen Jean is my co-host, so you know what we do. So, Queen Jean, you guys can hear more of her tomorrow night. But thank you, Queen.
You're welcome. Talk to you later. Peace and love, you guys.
Peace. 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 We got another caller out there, Boo, who wants to check in. Anonymous caller, hello.
Hey, how's it going? This is Brother Rock Kim, you know. I'm just kidding, you know, I'm just listening to you know, Mama Boo's story and I just wanted to say, man, you know, free all my niggas, man, all my niggas out the pen, they ain't do shit. They just killed a couple motherfuckers, but they deserved it. Fuck them niggas, man, free my niggas, man. You know what I mean? Yo, fuck.
Okay, I don't know what that was about. The homie hung up. I don't know. It was he called from an anonymous number. It was blocked, so I don't even know what that was about. You know, much love to you, homie. Whatever it was about, thanks for calling in. Boo, continuing on. We got a lot of love tonight. People checked in, much love. I'm sure it's a lot of people out there listening online that didn't call in, that just are listening to this incredible interview and your life story. Is there anybody out there specifically or that you can think of that you would want to send some love out that's listening right now or that may not be listening or just something you want to put out there that we did not talk about tonight or just some love you want to show to anybody out there all over the world?
Well, of course, I want to show love to my babies, my three pimps. Show love to my mom as well for having me. You know what I'm saying? I mean, throughout the bad and the good, it made me who I am today. So I have to appreciate that as well. You know, I got to give a shout out to the OG Cree, you know, because he'd been like my counselor through last year, through everything that was going on, crazy or whatever, and just pushing me like, man, handle your business, do your shit. So, you know, of course, shout out to him. I just want to shout out to everybody that's listening. Like, thank you for tuning in to even hear my voice and listening to what I'm saying. So that's pretty much it. And, of course, I got to give you a shout out, the OG G-Lew. I got to give you a shout out for show for always being like, you 100. Like, I know when I called and had that little blooper moment. I was so embarrassed that you and Queen Jean, y'all have my back, front, and sides, as she said.
That's right.
The G-Lew Show for even giving me this platform to even be able to speak on. So I really appreciate you and everybody that participate with the show as well.
Thank you. Thank you, Boo. We appreciate you as well. You're a part of our family now. As every show I do, I always incorporate you and show love. You know, because I believe you're part of the family now. You have a lasting effect on not only me, but Queen and everybody incorporated with the show. They always tell me they love Mama Boo. You know what I mean? So you're a part
of
the family. Tell us. Yeah. But tell us now, though. Tell us, though, because you got your own show that you do on YouTube and all of that right there. Tell us about the Mama Boo show and what's that all about, how it came about, and where they can tune in to catch new episodes of the Mama Boo Show. Tell us about that.
Well, that came about by so many people reaching out to me and wanting to hear more. So, you know, with talking to my daughter, what have you, it's like I should just start my own little YouTube intimate talk with Mama Boo. And she's like, yeah, you should. You know, but she'd be so cavalier with everything. She's like, oh, yeah, sure. So I started that and just basically whatever topics that come to my mind are different guests or whatever, and we just sit there and really shoot the shit. And I don't know if people are aware, but I don't edit anything. So I'm giving y'all raw and uncut. I'm not going back, taking this part out. Oh, I said this, and I don't want y'all to hear that. No, what I'm downloading is from start to finish, period. So, but that show is just more so people can really see who I am as a person other than just the interviews or other than just me on social media with little short videos or pictures or whatever. You can actually see that I'm a human being. I'm goofy. You know what I'm saying? I'll be having a lot to say, and I'm loud, so you guys can actually see who I am. and talk on different topics and hope to get feedback and I hope to change somebody's mind about something in a positive way.
Right. And let me say this, the topics are like, there's no certain topics. You don't speak about one thing or particular, or you don't think you're going to go in there and hear gang shit and all that. She talks about everything and incorporates her family, her kids, talks about women issues, homie issues, a lot of different stuff. There's nothing really off topic or, you know, that she does on there. It's always different topics, different conversations, and it's a great channel. I tune in to every episode, so I would advise you all to do the same. Tell them the page and where it's at, the link and all of that, where they can go to it, like, right now after they finish this and get caught up on all the episodes you already have.
Well, YouTube, you can YouTube Mama Boo Boo, MomaBooBoo. And tune in, subscribe, and also share. I get a lot of people that's viewing the videos and may comment on Instagram in my inbox. A lot of people don't really like comment on YouTube. But my thing about it is share it. You know, I know people want to keep me to themselves, but I'm going to need y'all not to keep me to yourself and share. Share my mouth. Share me on the couch.
Right.
So once again, it's YouTube, Mama Boo Boo, MomaBooBoo. Or you can follow me on IG at MomaBoo132, Mama Boo 132.
132. What that Athens like. Hey, but let me ask you this. What has been the response, do you think, overall from everything you've been doing recently, from your interviews on Street Gangs, you know, different platforms, you know, where you're getting your voice and your story out? What has been the overall feedback from, like, you know, of course, people that don't know you and all around the world, they're intrigued by your story. They love these stories. And that's, like, the biggest topics online because, you know, this L.A. culture is just took off and everybody wants that culture, and that's why we got gangs everywhere now and everybody's intrigued by this gang shit or whatever. But what has been the overall, like, feedback from not only around the world, I'm sure you see the comments and stuff on YouTube, but the stuff we can see, people that you know, that know you and all of that, and how has the feedback been? Do they appreciate it? Are they proud of you? Or, like, what is the overall feedback been from what you've been doing recently?
Well, the feedback from people that personally know me, I mean, whether it's hard to believe or not, I really don't get no feedback from people that actually personally know me. I probably get maybe 2-3% of feedback, like, you know, I'm proud of you. Any and everything that people directly to me is all positive. I haven't had not one person say nothing directly to me in a disrespectful or a messed up manner. Now, as far as like the Street Gang interview or whatever, if you go through there, you will see people saying stupid stuff. But as far as indirectly to me, everything, I have not ran across nobody that said anything negative to me, but majority of everybody that speak to me are strangers. Majority of the women that go in my inbox, and the ages vary. You know, I've talked to maybe someone, I think she was about 13, 14, and I was kind of in contact with her last year, and she, I haven't been speaking to her lately or what have you. But it'd be women that's older than me, and they're telling me that I inspired them, which that right there is, like, something that really, like, just go through my whole fiber of me, where it's just, like, so good. You know what I'm saying? That there are women out there that's older than me looking and listening to my story that I'm inspiring, you know. So it's just been totally positive. Like, have no one got at me with no bull crap, and I've even had Crips to get at me on a positive note as well. So it's just been positive. I'm just so blessed. I'm just enjoying it. I'm around here glowing because the people got me so happy. Like, seriously. I'll be happy every day.
Right. And that's the power of this, you know, it's a good, lot of good bads about the internet. Like, we spoke about some of the bads, but the good part is that you get to reach people that you will never see or never know and that love you, you know, from afar. And I want to ask you this, speaking about what we just spoke on, the positive or negative or not at all feedback from people that you even know. What do you think about, because I feel this way too, but what do you think about the people, like you said, you now doing a lot of positive things, you're reaching hundreds of thousands of people, but you still only get maybe 2% of you know, feedback or people that really know you, that really support what you're doing, opposed to 90% people that don't even know you. I mean, how is that, and how does that make you feel, or do you care at all? And And also, how do you feel? Because you know how this shit goes. With same thing we're talking about, you're only getting 2, 3%, 10% of people that know you, but 90% for people that don't know you. But once you blow and now some big shit happens, now them same people, though, that you did know is on your coattail, you know, this and that, but weren't here for the struggle or supported what you're doing. How do you feel about that overall?
I just say, as far as what I feel about it, I feel that it's kind of hurtful, but I don't dwell on it, because my thing is, it's a lot of people that have actually seen me in these moments of what I speak on. They've been there at ground zero during all this time, as far as me leaving the kid's daddy. I mean, rather, I was talking about what was really going on and all the extra stuff that was going on they didn't know. They was there. You get what I'm saying? When I was at school being a bad kid, fighting, and people didn't see me fighting and tearing up, not actually tearing up the hood, but tearing bitches up around the hood. They not saying nothing. You get what I'm saying? But it's like, it's a hurtful thing, because I feel like I'm actually, for the ones that's older than me, I'm actually one of y'all babies. You know what I'm saying? And now that I'm turning my life around and it reflects in my kids, y'all not saying nothing. But then if someone will be like, oh, I saw your video. And it's like, oh, okay. You know, and it's like, you never commented, no nothing. And you actually know me. So, but my thing is, once everything blow, because it's going to blow. That's like a sure thing. I'm not finna be
that
right
far
here too much longer. It's not going to happen. But once I do blow, I feel like y'all motherfuckers keep the same motherfucking energy. Period.
Right. But one more thing, and this is like a devil's advocate thing. How do you deal with that? I'm sure you can't answer that because we don't know, you know. But I'm sure a lot of celebrity or people who have made it, how do you deal with that at that point? It's easy to say, yeah, you keep that same energy, but now you got family and people who this and that, and now you're moving on to a different part of your life or progress, and you have to disassociate yourself with those people. You know what I mean? Even though they may be family or whatnot, but you know in your heart they weren't here, though, you know, for the struggle.
Well, throughout this whole struggle with the year before last and last year, as far as family, I have not had one family member. Now, no, I will take that back, my brother on my daddy's side. That's the only one. Other than that, I have had not one person to reach out to me or to talk to me or to say anything to me at all. Like, as far as in my mama's side, because I really don't deal with my daddy's side. I'm just now starting to get linked to a lot of them. But as far as in my mama's side, I do not have no family members saying anything to me. And my thing about that is, I'm not going to walk around and be bitter. I'm not going to be mad. But I feel like I keep that same motherfucking energy. Because I'm going to be happy and turned up and smiling and giggling. And you come over here asking me something that's dumb, I'm going to tell your ass is dumb and get out of my face. Keep that same energy from 2019 to 2020. Period. But I'm not going to be mad about it. I'm not going to be mad, because a lot of people say that people come into money or come into wealth or come into fame and they change. But this is the thing that I'm seeing right now. I had two particular people that I love to death. I still love them to death. But during the issue at the end of the year, I've always been there for them. I've been knowing them maybe 5, 6 years, and I've been there for them like, I'm not even going to go into depth. But I've been there for them, and they have been there for me as well. But when that issue happened at the end of the year, neither one of them called and reached out to me to be like, Boo or Keisha, are you all right? Like, what's going on, dude? And that right there, like, that's the most thing that then hurted me with everything. And then it'll be one of those things later on down the time where someone be like, well, yeah, because Keisha got money and she changed. No, when I needed my friend, when I needed my family people, y'all stepped away from me in the midst of my storm. So when I overcome this storm, don't be in the media talking about she brand new, she acted brand new. Because I don't think people really act like that. I think people start showing themselves when you're manifesting into something else. They start showing themselves. And then what you would do is step back, because that's negative energy. I'm on positive stuff. I can't grow negatively. So I'm trying to grow positively, so I need to let you go for right now. And then people interpret that as you got money, you got fame, and now you don't fuck with us no more. No, you X yourself out. And that's where I'm at with it, because I'm not doing nothing malicious. I'm not mean to nobody. I'm not nothing. I'm like the most politest person you can meet. And I've always been like that until you turn that switch, and then I'm somebody else. But other than that, I'm cool. Just the way I talk and the way I act on social media, that's me in for real life. I'm not motherfucking acting on social media. That's me. That's me, and that's actually them kids. So if you feel as if you just want to step back because maybe I got too much going on or whatever the case may be, I'm not inflicting that I'm too good for you. That's not how I'm acting towards you, but you stepped away in a moment of me needing you. So when I sprout, don't be like she acting brand new, because I'm not, because you showed yourself in the midst of my storm. So that's where I'm at with it. My thing is, everybody just keep the same energy. Keep the same energy. If you one of the people that be like, hey, I saw your video, keep that same energy. Be like, hey, I saw one of your videos. Don't be like, can I get in one of your videos? Because I'm going to be like, no, keep that same energy.
Okay.
So
okay.
If you be like, she got all these people around her and all these people are strangers. They don't even know her like I know her. I knew her at ground zero. Okay, but they showed me love in my transition.
Period.
So it's a difference.
Like they say.
It's the difference. So I'm just going to keep the same energy, people.
Yeah. That part right there. Mama Boo. Mama
That part right
Boo.
There.
Hey, Boo, 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 Boo. Check this out in closing, right? What do you want to tell the people? You know, they heard the whole story. They heard the transgression, the transition of Mama Boo to who she is today. What do you want to tell the people in closing that, you know, we didn't speak about it or whatever, but you just want to leave them with this about Mama Boo? Don't ever get no other misconception about me. This is from me right here. What do you want to tell the people in closing in this interview about Mama Boo?
What I will say is I get a lot of people that tell me that I look unapproachable, and that's not true. I am a genuine person. I'm a solid person. I'm an honest person. I would say don't judge people by what they look like. My thing to people is start talking to each other. You know, like I had a young lady that was in a car with me, and she was just talking to whatever. And like I told her, you know, you should start talking to everybody about what it is that you're doing, and you may get information. Talk to bums. Talk to everybody. Because my thing about it is people that have the worst life that we see, they have a lot of knowledge, a lot of input on what not to do or what you should do. So my thing is start talking to each other. Start assisting each other. You know, take the step forward to checking these badass kids. I mean, and you don't have to do it in a negative manner. A lot of these kids won't love. They won't structure. You know, stop walking by, seeing these kids doing off-the-wall stuff and just keeping it moving. But then again, at the same time, you don't know. The kid may have a gun. Whatever the case, my thing is start talking to each other. Pass the love. What's the problem? Like, what is the problem? My thing is be yourself and talk to people. And as far as I'm concerned, what you see is what you get. And you don't want what you don't see. Promise.
Mama Boo. Mama Boo. Mama Boo. I want to ask you, too, before we close. How did you think I did as an interviewer? How would you grade this interview with G-Lew tonight?
I give you an A, sir.
Oh, shit.
I give you an A.
Okay.
Because for one, I'm still nervous right now, but as always, you make it smooth. You make it smooth. You make it smooth.
Okay.
We over here spilling tea. And you over there sipping the tea, you know, it was smooth. You got to sip it slowly, but it was smooth.
Right.
I can't pour too fast.
Right. Thank you, baby. I just wanted your input on that. And I want to thank you again. I can't thank you enough for joining us tonight. Episode number 8, Mama Boo, Intimate Conversations with Mama Boo, which is low-key the name of her show and channel on YouTube. Go check that out. Go follow her on Instagram, Mama Boo, Boo 132.
No,
Instagram. Got it lit. Yeah, M-O-M-A, Boo 132 Instagram. She got it lit. YouTube is lit. Follow her. She has street gang. Shit is blew up. You know, she's a celebrity now, but she's still Mama Boo.
I am not a celebrity. I think my motorcycle is the celebrity. I think puss is the celebrity.
Yeah, we did. That's one thing we did not speak on briefly. We got a couple minutes. I didn't ask you about the motorcycle thing, man. We didn't speak about that. Briefly tell the people about your life and, you know, your newfound, you know, life in your bike puss and you know, how you get out and everything. You're a real, real, real rider.
Oh, well, yeah. I mean, as far as, like I say, don't judge a book. Because you guys with your motorcycles or whatever, don't pull up next to me thinking that all this pink right here, you just gonna dog me and you just gonna what my son say, you gonna, he got a little phrase or whatever, but you not just gonna leave me on no turns or no straightaway. Just FYI. But yeah, Puss got her own little fan base because just to speak on that, the lady that I did the interview with, Sweden, I actually pulled up with my daughter, and before the interview was over, she was like, you know, can you go get your bike? Because I really would like to take a picture and interview you on your bike. And I'm looking at this lady like, the fucking bike? Really? So yeah, Puss have her own fans. So it is what it is. I mean, you're catching me on my bike if you can catch me, but I doubt it. But try it. I would love to see you try it.
Okay. I wanted to speak on that because that's another part of your life. That's a big part of your life, your bike life. And I get worried about you on that bike, but you can handle it, you know. So shout out to the bike life. Shout out to Puss, you know. and again, thank you, Wu. This was a great episode, and really appreciate you. You know, all of that, everything was great, and I'm glad you took out the time to grace our episode number 8 of the G-Lew Show podcast. Again, go follow Boo, Instagram, YouTube. The page is blowing up. Show support, like, share the page, share the channels, the videos, share it on YouTube, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, so the shit can blow up. And I'm waiting on that book as well, Boo. When can we expect the book?
I don't know. Like, I'm not going to put no pressure on myself no damn more. I did that. I learned from that.
Okay.
But now I'm more smooth in my writing, so it's going to be soon. Just everybody stay tuned. I got y'all. I got something for y'all to read. Believe that.
Okay. Now, how about a documentary? Can we... That's something I would love to see. You know, we got the digital age and all that. I would love to see a documentary on Mama Boo, you know, your life and all of that. And maybe can we expect anything like that after the book or in the future?
I mean, I'm open to that. If someone were to hit me up about that and that is serious, you know, that I was already in the film production or whatever the case may be, hit me up. I mean, I would love to do that. Of course, that's something that's on the to-do list. So, I mean, for the people out there in G-Lew land, if you know somebody, you the person, hit me up. I would love to do that. Absolutely.
Okay, and I want to ask you this. Speaking on that, the movie thing, we talked about this before, but I want to mention it because you have another homeboy from your neighborhood who's in the movie industry. Have you ever thought about tapping in with him to make those connections, or is that not something you want to do? You know, the homie Bone.
Oh, yeah.
You know, been
I
in
have,
the industry
I have
for
talked
years.
About Yeah, I have talked about that with him. So, yeah, that's in the making. But, you know, he stayed busy. So, but, yeah, that's in the making as well. I reach out to him quite often, and I'm talking about Bone. So, of course, that's in the making. I mean, I'm all over the plate with everything. I'm open to anything that's going to put money in my pocket and be on a positive note as far as in my brand. So that's where I'm at with it.
Okay. Once again, Miss Mama Boo, the legendary Mama Boo. I'm going to say that now because she is a legend.
Oh, dang.
The legendary Miss Mama Boo, my baby Boo. Much love, Boo. Thank you again for joining us tonight. It was incredible.
You're
I had
welcome.
A great time. It was my pleasure. Thank you again for everything. This show right here, this is a podcast number 8, and this will be broadcast on all the streaming sites by tomorrow, Apple Podcasts, Spotify. All of those major platforms where you can find your podcast, this will be there. So please show love, like, subscribe, give us a 5-star rating.
And
tell us
share.
How you like it, and share this shit, you know, so the world can hear Mama Boo's story. This shit need to be heard, man. Niggas quit playing. This shit need to be heard right here.
Right.
This Mama
I'm trying
Boo.
To keep me to y'allself.
This Mama Boo
and
right
share.
Here. Niggas quit playing, man. This Mama Boo right here, man. Stop playing, man. Athens finest. Boo, boo, boo. Thank you, baby, again. All love.
You're welcome. Thank you.
All right. Episode 8, the G-Lew Show podcast. Mama Boo Boo. And we out.
We out.
The Bronx, Hollywood, and cross the Atlantic, off a box of boulevard. Every town has an Elm Street, but not a Freddy Krueger. Don't get caught in the jungles of a port called Louis. On Rosecrans Path, Leander, rest our life. Three toppers to the left, fruit town is on the right. One by one, there was our power, proof, slave past door. And the only other bloodhood is Captain Ella Park. Hacienda, Swans, and Bounty Hunters, they call your number. Rolling 30s and 20, outlaws, Seuss, Rims will put you under. Cabbage Patch, Center Park, all report, Athens Park 2. Scottsdale neighborhood, halt on waterfront, all power route. LA Denver Lane, this one with Pasadena Avenues, Bloodstone, Eagle Wood Family, the Pueblos, Bloodstone Villas, Block P, Stone, Circle City, and Eastside. Bishops got it going on with the NG's, Queen Creek, BNG's. Ain't no stopping up. Village Town, Eastside, Pain, Crenshaw, Mafia, Bebop, Watt City, Stones in the skyline. Don't say cuz the blood, this is Pyru all the time.